Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. August 14, 1947, a new country was born. Flags were hoisted in green and white on either side of Indian boundary. August 15, 1947. After a long battle with the imperial powers, a country known for its civilizational values, richness, diversity and myriad languages and culture was blossoming with orange, white and green with the motto of Satyameva Jayate. And across the borders, as trains moved from one region to another, the floor was soaked with red. There were people coming in with no support, no backing, hit by emotions, tears welled up in eyes and grief engulfing them. One steel frame stood up with the support of Vallabhai Patel, and that's Civil Service of India. With government missionary working day in and day out, led by the political executive, there were silent workers behind the curtains to stop the pain and grief. From then till today, this body has been working relentlessly to pull people out of poverty. The civil service, as the name denotes, is a service towards our country. And you, aspiring to be one, have just few days to slog, work hard by breaking your own benchmarks and records. Have no mercy for yourself till you reach your magical destiny of serving this motherland. Unlock your hidden strength and bounce back till you reach your goal. Thus, these few days decide your oath, dedication to crack the toughest examination of India. Let's get started and look into the first article. The first article says, bombers visited Kashmir, Kerala, Bengaluru, according to the Sri Lankan Army Chief. What is the context? Sri Lankan Army Chief has said, some of the suicide bombers who carried out country's worst terror attack on Easter last month had visited Kashmir, Kerala for some sorts of training or to make some more links with other foreign outfits. When you look into the details of this article, the terror outfit Islamic State had claimed responsibility for all those attacks that happened in Sri Lanka. But the government blamed the local extremist group, which is called as National Tawheed Jamaat. Army Chief currently says that these groups or these suicide bombers went up to certain other places to get some expertise or knowledge about the conduction of operation. They might have gone up to Kashmir, they might have gone up to Kerala or even to Bengaluru to get certain logistical support to conduct this inhumane and barbaric act, as they lacked expertise in bringing about this mayhem. The suicide bombers may also need to know how the equipment works, how the bombs are operated and how these bombs are activated. So for all this, they require certain training. So what the army chief goes about quoting is that these suicide bombers went from Sri Lanka to those places of Kashmir, Kerala and Bengaluru to create this massive massacre in the region of Sri Lanka. While we look into all this, what we also have to understand is we'll have to look at one of the concepts of security, and that is de-radicalization. De-radicalization refers to the process of divorcing a person voluntarily, emotionally through the family or any which ways, so that that person does not subscribe to extremes of ideology. What do we mean by it? There is a person who is already indoctrinated with illogical thoughts. This person can be a future threat. He can engage himself in a terrorist activity. This has been identified. So the minute you have identified this individual who is indoctrinated with all those thoughts, illogical talks, we need to identify and dissociate this person from this illogical thinking. So all the ill thoughts, extreme of views and ideas which can go against the society will have to be removed. So de-radicalization here means that we are removing all those ill thoughts that are present in the mind of the people. Give him the original meaning of that particular religion, not the misinterpretation of that religion, so that we can ensure that this person will not be a terrorist in the future. So de-radicalization basically means removing those extreme of ideas that is prevalent within that person. Next, what we have is the disengagement. Disengagement basically means that this person is currently attached to a terrorist organization. So this person can be a future threat. So disengagement currently means that this person who is associated with a particular terrorist outfit will be blocked from reaching that particular organization. So this is a temporary phase. We are not letting this person reach that terrorist organization, but the idea here is to stop it temporarily. We are not de-radicalizing it. We are not removing any of the views, but only stopping that person from committing this heinous act temporarily. So on de-radicalization, it is a permanent move where we are making sure that all extreme of views are removed. But in disengagement, the views are still persistent in that person, but we are blocking him from reaching that particular terrorist organization so that he does not engage in this activity, at least temporarily. Then there is a concept called as counter-radicalization. This means that all the measures the government, the civil society, the family, and any of them take in order to ensure that there is no future generation which take up this particular activity. So de-radicalization is removing of thoughts. Disengagement is stopping that person from engaging into that activity temporarily. And counter-radicalization is ensuring that future generation does not engage in the terrorist activity. Now the question is, why do people get radicalized? The victims of extremism who fall prey are spiritually hungry. They are dedicated to their faith, but have limited knowledge of their religion and being desperate, naive, or simply in need of money. They have no idea of their religion. They have no idea of its interpretation, and they may also need some money to bring about changes in their personal life. This is when the person closer to this individual through some channels gets to know this person and makes use of this gullibility. And all those trying to recruit such people try to cater to their needs and interests, and also by pressure tactics. So the victim is then indoctrinated, starts trusting this person who is already involved with a radical group. In order to ensure this does not happen, there are two approaches that security personnel have. What are these two approaches? One, we have the hard approach. The other is a soft approach counter-terrorism move. The hard approach in itself is a counter-terrorism approach, which is militaristic in approach, which involves targeted assassinations or even warfare to eliminate this individual. The second approach is the soft counter-terrorism. This is a program that is initiated by the security personnel to undo the radicalization process by engineering the return of this person to the moderate society. And this is usually done by providing him some stable support, probing some original reasons for radicalizing, and divorcing this person from their extreme of beliefs and social contacts. Now that we have understood what are the various types, let's also understand the various measures that have been taken by India to prevent radicalization. At present, if the law enforcement agencies in the country find out that there is an individual who is indoctrinated with radical views, then such person will be immediately referred to the de-radicalization centers. The person who is identified with this extreme of views will then be sent to the de-radicalization centers, where he'll be provided counseling. The counseling can be provided by the police or by the counselors of that particular ideology to which that individual belongs to. So the person's activities are monitored to prevent any type of backsliding, or so that he does not get back to his past. These measures are currently being employed in the states of Maharashtra as well as in Telangana. The media campaigns, the internet are also being constantly monitored by the security people, and public relation programs, and then important lectures are also delivered so that this extreme of view is also nullified. On the hard power mode, India also has the anti-terrorist courts, which continue to prevent people from traveling to Iraq and Syria in an attempt to join the ISIS. Another important example that India can also draw is from Austria. Austria has come up with one of the important and mind-blowing programs called as Counseling Center for Extremism. This counseling center is aimed for the family members, teachers, and friends who fear that someone close to them is in the danger of becoming radicalized. So what do? They immediately call up a hotline. This hotline has a group of advisors. These advisors are trained in crisis intervention who can visit all these worried families or the friends very quickly and ensure that this person is de-radicalized from those indoctrinated principles. This advice is also free and anonymous. Why are we discussing this? That is because India is also looking at this particular center so that it can adopt this model into the Indian society. Now, after all the discussion that we have done, we will also have to know the significance of de-radicalization. The most important point is all those people who have been de-radicalized can also help us in getting certain intelligence inputs. So they will yield us all the valuable intelligence and evidence that is required against the terrorist groups. These programs of de-radicalization are comparatively cheaper than the hard power approach. When there is hard power approach, you require a lot of logistics. You require a lot of intelligence as well. And this will require a lot of human power as well as equipment. But when it comes to de-radicalization, the number of human power that is required is less. At the same time, it becomes comparatively cheaper than the hard power. But what we need to understand is this process of de-radicalization cannot be seen in isolation. We cannot always take the soft approach. For the security of the country, for the integrity of the country, India will have to ensure both hard power as well as the soft approach is used simultaneously to engage with all these terrorists so that we do not lose the innocence due to this barbaric act. This article is speaking about Indian Gaur. It is also called as Indian bison. Let's look into some of the facts which can be important from your preliminary examination point of view. It is native to South and Southeast Asia. Its IUCN status is vulnerable. It is the largest extant bovine. The Gaur is the tallest of all the wild cattle species. The domesticated form of Gaur is called as Gayal or also Mithun. So kindly remember these facts because this can be likely asked in your preliminary examination. This article is speaking about Gachiroli massacre. The entire discussion of this security threat has already been analyzed on 2nd of May 2019 under our first topic, so kindly look into it. However, what this article says is the CRPF or the Central Reserve Police Force are the security group which looks into areas that is affected by Naxalism and Maoism. They conduct operations on the ground and control the anti-state forces. They are aware of the weaknesses, target points of all the Naxals where they are operating. They work in huge numbers, which is effective to control the rise of ideological warfare that is affecting the state as well as its people. Currently, when you look into the context, it says there were people from the CRPF who were employed in Maharashtra. But due to elections in West Bengal, CRPF personnel were pulled in from multiple sources across India due to alarming law and order issue that was prevalent in West Bengal. Since the number of CRPF personnel were reduced, were asked to move out, this reduction in numbers has caused this attack is what this article is speaking about. This article, steering away from diesel, is a very important concept and this has already been explained on 26th April 2019 under the second topic, Bharat Stage Norms. So kindly look into it for a detailed explanation of this article. This article is speaking about one of the important geographical situations called as the Pacific Decadal Oscillation. Let's understand the background first. Northeast India is one of the wettest places on earth as well as in India. Some places which used to get as high as 3000 mm of rain during the monsoon season have seen a drop of about 25 to 30%. So what is the present context? A team of researchers from the Indian Institute of Tropical Meteorology Pune and Assam University are set out to understand whether this decline is caused by an anthropogenic activity which is due to the human made causes or is it due to the natural changes. This article says that this is due to one of the natural occurrences that is happening in the nature, and that particular natural occurrence or the geographical condition is called as the Pacific Decadal Oscillation. Let's try and understand what this Pacific Decadal Oscillation is all about. The Pacific Decadal Oscillation is nothing but the variation of the sea temperature, and this takes place in the region of Pacific Ocean along the latitude of about 20 degrees north. So as the name indicates, these are the climate events that cover vast areas of the Pacific Ocean over the periods of decades. It includes 10 years, 20 or 30 years. Now there are two phases in the Pacific Decadal Oscillation. One is the warm or the positive phase, the other is the negative phase. In the Pacific Ocean, there are two regions. You have the eastern region, you also have the western region. During the warm or the positive phase, the western Pacific across this part becomes comparatively cooler, and this part across the east becomes warmer. From the principles of geography, we know that as it gets cooler, it becomes a high pressure region, and as it becomes warmer, it becomes a low pressure region. This development of high pressure starts moving or drifting the wind from the region of high pressure to the region of low pressure. So all the moisture laden winds starts moving from the region of west towards the east. This also means it is very similar to the El Nino that we have seen in our earlier classes. Now let's understand the negative phase. The negative phase is just the reversal of what happens in the positive phase. During the negative phase, the western region becomes comparatively warmer and the eastern region becomes comparatively cooler. There is development of high pressure in this region and there is development of low pressure in this region. So the moisture laden winds start moving from the region of high pressure towards the low pressure. Under this particular condition, this particular region will experience the good rainfall. And this region in the North America will experience drought-like situation. So as we have discussed earlier in our classes, this is similar to La Nina. So according to the research that has been conducted by this institute, what they say is the warm phase or the positive phase tends to cause drought-like situation or lesser rainfall in the region of northeast. So when we look into the statistics, the team used observed rainfall and sea surface temperature data for the period between 1901 to 2014 for their study. The results show out that reduction in rainfall during a major part of the last 114 years may be associated with global man-made factors, while the trend during the last 36 years is associated with the natural phenomena, and that is the Pacific Decadal Oscillation. The article further here has given certain recommendations which has been posted by the researchers. So what these researchers go on to say is there has been a change in the land cover. There has been deforestation that has been taking place in the northeast of India. And this deforestation could potentially result in more natural disasters. For example, the flash floods, the landslides, and also damage the crops and diversity. So it has requested the government of India and the policy makers to look into the long-term predictions and plan the construction of dams, power plants, etc. to prevent the loss of property as well as the rainfall that is impacting this particular region. This article here is speaking about a specific type of robot called as the Endobot. This Endobot is marketed by an IIT Madras incubated startup, Solinus Integrity, which is founded by the researchers who are working with the IIT Madras. This will basically check the pipelines for all the leaks as well as faults within the pipeline. Now the question is, what was the need of this robo? When we have to transport water, we have huge pipeline connections. These huge pipeline connections helps in movement of water from one region to another. But the problem with this pipeline is we do not know what's happening internally within the pipeline. When there is any external problems, the water surfaces out of this pipeline, we would be able to understand that there is an issue with respect to this pipe as well as the movement of water. But what happens internally, we are not sure. In order to understand what happens internally within the pipe, in order to prevent the leakage as well as other types of corrosion, this project was initiated. So what happens in this particular project? This project is called as Endobot. This is a robo. This has a height of about 6 inches. And this robo can study any of the irregularities within the pipe connection if it has a diameter which is more than 8 inches. If the diameter of this pipeline is less than 6 inches or less than 8 inches, this robo will not be of effective use. But in case the diameter of this pipeline is 8 inches and greater, then we can use this particular endobo. This robo is attached with the conveyor belt, as we can see from the picture. This also has a camera as well. So this is connected by a conveyor belt and it has four wheels so that it is able to moderate within this particular pipeline. So as it moves, because of the camera that is mounted on this robo, it will be able to capture the video and would be able to transmit a live feed of what is happening internally. This data, as it reaches the entry point, will be analyzed further by the software that is built up by this team and give relevant information that is required for the team to take relevant action. So what is the significant aspect? It will help in reduction of the water leakages, and it will ensure in case there is any corrosion within this particular system because of the laser based techniques that is also used in this robo, and it will also make sure that all the losses that we currently have due to leakage of water is comparatively reduced. This article, Chips at Stake in PepsiCo Farmers, will be explained on our economy this section. Another article with respect to the Reserve Bank of India and its loan defaulters will also be explained in our economy section. So these two articles, you don't have to worry, will be explained in our economy section. So let's look into some of the practice questions. Gravity Rat, recently seen in news, is a... It is a malware allegedly designed by the Pakistani hackers. Let's look into the next practice question. Al-Qaeda in Islamic Maghreb is an Islamist militant organization which aims to overthrow which government? The answer is Algeria. Consider the following with respect to Gaganyaan. When it achieves the mission, India would be the third nation to circle Earth. The Russian side has offered a ride to the Indian astronaut, a short visit to the International Space Station. Which of the above statements are correct? The answer to this is two only. Why? Because when India accomplishes this, it will not be the third country, but instead it will be the fourth country, because we already have USA, Russia and China, which has already accomplished this particular feat. Arrange the following dopes in Punjab region from west to east: Rechna, Chaj, Bist and Bari. The answer for this is 2, 1, 4, 3. Let's look into the explanation. First, we have the Jaj dope. The Jaj dope is also called the Chaj dope. Then we have the Rechna, the Bari, as well as the Bist. So that is why the arrangement for this is 2, 1, 4, 3. Let's look into the previous year practice question. With reference to Organization for Prohibition of Chemical Weapons, consider the following statement. It is an organization of European Union in working relation with NATO and World Health Organization. This is a wrong statement. It monitors chemical industry to prevent new weapons from emerging. Right. It provides assistance and protection to states against chemical weapon threats. This is also right. So the answer for this is 2 and 3 only. So this is it for today. Thank you for watching. All the best.